Hello everyone, welcome to the lecture series on computer architecture and organization. This is our second lecture in unit 3, the processor. In this lecture we are going to see about the logic design conventions. So regarding the logic design conventions, there are two functional elements. One is the element that operates on data, which is called the combinational element. Examples are AND gate or an arithmetic and logical unit. And the second is that elements that contain the data, which is called the state elements or sequential element. So the best example for state and sequential elements are registers and the memory. So if you see about this combinational elements, the elements that operate on data values are all combinational, which means that their output depends only on the current inputs. Given the same input, a combinational element always produces the same output. Okay. So for the example is arithmetic and logic unit. So this combinational logic simply reads the input data from one register and writes output data to another or the same register. So read or write happens in a single cycle. This combinational element cannot store data from one cycle to a future one, which is a quick transition from low to high or vice versa. So because only state elements can store a data value, any collection of combinational logic must have its input come from a set of state elements and its output return into a set of state elements. The inputs are values that were written in a previous clock cycle, while the outputs are values that can be used in the following clock cycle. So among these two figures, the first one, this shows the two state elements surrounding a block of combinational logic which operates in a single clock cycle. That is, all the signals must propagate from the state element 1 through the combinational logic and to state element 2 in the time of one clock cycle. So the time necessary for the signals to reach state element 2 defines the length of the clock cycle. For simplicity, we haven't used any write control signal here, because when a state element is written on every active clock edge. In contrast, if a state element is not updated on every clock, then an explicit write control signal is required. Both the clock signal and the write control signals are inputs, and the state element is changed only when the write control signal is asserted and a clock edge occurs. So if you see about the second diagram, that is the second figure. So only an edge triggered methodology allows us to read the contents of a register, send the value through some combinational logic and write that register in the same clock cycle. So this second one is a very good example. It doesn't matter whether we assume that all writes take place on the rising clock edge or on the falling clock edge, because the inputs to the combinational logic block cannot change except on the chosen clock edge. So throughout this chapter, we are using only the rising clock edge. With an edge trigger timing methodology, there is no feedback within a single clock cycle, and this logic works correctly. So if you see about the set reset latch, that is unclocked one. So this is the latch. Here we are having S bar and R bar. If you see this theory of this, a set reset latch made from two cross coupled NAND gates is a basic memory unit here. But both the S bar and R bar are 1, then either one of the following two states is stable. That is, Q is equal to 1 and Q bar is equal to 0. That is first state. And the second state is Q is equal to 0 and Q bar is equal to 1. And the latch will continue in the current stable state. So now if S bar changes to 0 while R bar remains at 1, then the latch is forced to the exactly one possible state A. If R bar changes to 0 while S bar remains at 1, the latch is forced to the exactly one possible state B. So the latch remembers which of S bar or R bar was lost 0 during the time they are both 1. So when both S bar and R bar are 0, the exactly one stable state is Q is equal to Q bar is equal to 1. However, if after that both S bar and R bar return to 1, the latch must then jump non-deterministically to one of the stable states A or B, which is undesirable behavior here. If you see about the synchronous logic, that is clocked latches and flip-flops, clocks are used in synchronous logic to determine when a state element is to be updated. In level-triggered clocking methodology, either the state changes only when the clock is high or only when it is low. So in edge-triggered clocking methodology, either the rising edge or the falling edge is active, that is states change only on the rising edges or only on the falling edge. So latches are level triggered, flip-flops are edge triggered. So if you see about this SR, clocked SR latch, state can change only when the clock is high. But the potential problem is both inputs S bar is equal to 0 and R bar is equal to 0 will cause a non-deterministic behavior. So this is the clocked D latch. Here the states can change only when the clock is high. Only the single data input can be given compared to SR latch. No problem with non-deterministic behavior. So this is the clocked D flip-flop. It is negative edge triggered. This is made from 3 SR latches. So we are using the state elements on the data path. Example, in register file, we are using these state elements. Registers are implemented with arrays of D flip-flops. Here, the register file with 2 read ports and 1 write port is implemented. The register file has a clock and a control signal. If you see the first figure, the read ports are implemented with a pair of multiplexers, 5-bit multiplexers for 32 registers. We are in need of a pair of multiplexers because we need to select 2 register, read registers. Similarly, if you see the right side figure, write port is implemented using a decoder, that is 5 to 32 decoder for 32 register. Clock is relevant to write as register state may change only at the clock edge. So that's all about this lecture. Stay tuned. Thank you.